catching it at any stage generally is still quite treatable and with the potential for cure. Success rates are outstanding. If we find a cancer in the first stage, first or even second stage, the chances of curing it are greater than 80 to 90%, depending on where exactly it is and some of the nuances of the care and the person's health. Even stage 4 cancer, something that is caught rather later, is still potentially curable. And I think that's one of the more important things as well. Is clearly it's important to find it early. Your prognosis is much, much better. The chance of cure much higher. Even with stage 4 cancers, the cure rates can be anywhere from 30 to 50%, sometimes even slightly higher. Head and neck cancer is a cancer that tends to be related to smoking cigarettes, chewing tobacco, alcohol, but also a virus named human papillomavirus. And for all of those causes, catching the diagnosis early is the most important thing as far as assuring a positive and a good outcome. Human papillomavirus clearly has been most solidly associated with cervical cancer. However, what we found is that cancers, particularly of the tonsil and the base of the tongue, the very back of the tongue, do tend to be associated with human papillomavirus in as many as 70% of cases. And what we know about that is that those patients do tend to be younger. It tends to occur in the early to mid-50s, that their prognosis is clearly better, and that the treatment for it tends to be based with radiation therapy. Sometimes chemotherapy, in fact, not infrequently, chemotherapy will also be used in addition to the radiation for the human papillomavirus-associated cancers. We also know that it is associated with frequent sex partners, likely at a younger age, and oral sex. There's an association with oral sex as well. Smoking and human papillomavirus actually can both be cofactors as well. So just because someone smokes doesn't mean that their cancer is not human papillomavirus related. And not every cancer in a non-smoker will be human papillomavirus associated, but certainly the likelihood is much higher, particularly in tonsil and base of tongue cancer. For all cancers of the head and neck, The things that you should be looking for are those symptoms that happen on one side and not the other, that persist for longer than 1 to 3 weeks. And for example, they will include things like hoarseness, which doesn't go away, and particularly hoarseness that gets progressively worse. A sore in the mouth, and particularly a lump in the mouth, a white patch in the mouth, or a red patch in the mouth that actually is not painful. One of the things that frequently surprises people is that they have a cancer in their mouth, yet it doesn't hurt. And we often associate cancers with pain, but in early stages especially, it's frequent that head and neck cancers won't be painful. Nosebleeds that occur on one side only, hearing loss that occurs on one side, and a neck mass, a lump in the neck that especially, again, those that are not painful, not associated with fever or a recent illness. Those should all be evaluated by a dentist or a physician. The treatment for head and neck cancer, it comes down to one of two major types, either surgery or radiation therapy. Those two are the only two curative types of treatment for head and neck cancer. We tend to then select that treatment which will give us the highest chance of cure, as well as the lowest chance of having complications and side effects from the treatment. And that tends to be, for cancers of the mouth, tends to be surgery first, and for cancers of the voice box, we often will use radiation first. For cancers of the throat, and areas of the voice box, sometimes surgery is better, sometimes radiation is better, and we basically have to make a determination based on exactly where the cancer is and what the stage of the cancer is. think that the most critical thing that we have to offer is what's called a multidisciplinary approach to care. And this is a care that's based on many different specialists working together to design and then institute the best possible treatment plan for the individual patient. And that includes what's called a tumor board, where we meet on at least a weekly basis or biweekly basis, where we discuss all new patients, their pathology, their biopsies, their radiology, that is their x-rays, their CAT scans, ultrasounds, will be evaluated by radiologists, pathologists, and then the group of surgeons and medical oncologists, radiation oncologists, dental oncologists, and other specialists particular to that type of disease will discuss options of care and then present what they think is the best treatment. The patient will then be presented with that result, and then we can institute that based again on having multiple people that have areas of expertise in a given field, for example in speech and swallowing therapy, or in radiation oncology, or in social work, or our nurse case managers, which are really the first line and the fundamental glue that holds all of this together.